My name's Joanna Chambers and I'm a member of the Council of the AA, and I'd like to invite you all to the second of our series of conversations on the topic of housing in London. We started the conversation last week around the topic of who will build the housing London needs, and we're going to develop this further this week, and some of the interesting discussion we had as a result of that conversation last week, particularly on the topic of what the architect's role is in this going forward. And tonight's topic is quantity versus quality. Can we deliver the housing London needs and make great places? I'd like to introduce our chair for tonight, Alex Lifschutz, and it's Alex's birthday today as well. So, Alex, you'll probably be very familiar with. Alex has got a long established links with the AA. He studied here and is past president. After working for Foster Associates, he formed Lifschutz Davidson in 1986 and has worked on a range of projects, including work with the Coin Street Community Builders, and including within that the groundbreaking Oxo Tower and the cooperative housing on the South Bank. Recent projects also include a new sustainable community at Kidbrook. So he's very well placed to talk about the topic of how we meet London's housing needs. So over to you, Alex. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just introduce our guest speakers? There are four of them. Bob Ellis over there, who most of you will know, partner of Ellis and Morrison, has won with his practice 35 RIBA awards and plenty more besides. He was jointly responsible for the master plan for the Olympics, so a very big site planned for a number of different uses. And with other developers, King's Cross, Brent Cross, Greenwich Peninsula, Canada Water, so very interesting large developments in London. And he's currently a member of CABE review panel and the London Mayor's Design Advisory Group. Colin here, rarely seen at the AA, I think, is a most important person. And we have to all be very polite to him, because he is a senior development and planning manager, but that doesn't really describe his role at the GLA. So he is responsible for looking at all the major developments coming through the local authorities up to the strategic authority. And as that strategic planning manager, he's looked at a number of schemes that have been referred to the mayor. Vauxhall 9 Elms Opportunity Area Planning Framework is the latest of those. And he's contributed to the London Plan, which is our sort of Bible, our guiding document, and all the recent opportunity area policies. David West, to his left, a planner and urban designer, also very experienced at strategic plans, and he's quite a radical with Studio Egret West. He has led the practice work, particularly recently at Middlehaven Docks in Middlesbrough, and abroad in St. Petersburg. Lots of other projects, Nottingham Science Park, Long Kesh in Belfast. So quite a range of different projects in different areas, and some of them, I think, of great relevance to London, although not in London. Finally, Vere van Gool, who is your local representative, in that she is graduated with honours at the AA and has worked for forensic architecture, looking at a house in Shadwell. She's a co-founder of MISS, M-I-S-S, a platform that celebrates women in art and architecture and design through international events, exhibitions and lectures in London, Bangkok and New York. She also lectures at Chelsea College of Art and Design. I think probably, is that correct? It says so here, so it's correct. So those are our four speakers. I think that the format for this is that I'll just give a few words of introduction, and then we'll ask, I think we could ask each of the speakers to give some thoughts on, they're being asked to give five key messages, key ideas on how we can confront the issue which is up on the screen here. Quantity versus quality. How can we deliver the housing London needs and make it a great place, make great places? So each of them is going to give you five thoughts, and then the debate is over to your questions or even, if you want, confrontations. Can I just start with three observations that I hope we can talk about at some point? This is a slide of the mayor's plan for the east side of London for the Thames Gateway, and it's a very interesting plan. I think it's Colin may talk about it a bit more, but it's quite an integrated plan for the first time, not just housing but other ideas, transport particularly. On the top left-hand side, you can see the growth of London's population, the estimated growth. For those of you who can't read at the back, 2011, 8.2 million, 2026, 9.5 million, and 2036 at the bottom, 10.1 million. So a considerable growth in population. And how do we do it? Do we build more densely in the existing inhabited parts of our city, or do we spread eastward? And maybe we have to do both. This is the plan for spreading eastward. And when we do it, the first question I have for you is, how do we do it in terms of making it something that appeals to Londoners, appeals to people who want to live in London, and is has a sort of regional quality rather than an international sort of global quality? So if I show you the next slide, this is a developer's model, and quite a lot of our schemes, our office and other offices, schemes are sold, as it were, in the Far East, in Russia, and so on. How do we make an architecture, if we're going to build to this quantity, that appeals to Londoners, that is somehow has the genetic quality of London, and that that is something that we're proud of? And I would say there is an issue here with scale. There's an issue here with, in inverted commas, style and architectural content. And if I can just take you back on this subject to Georgian London. During the Georgian period, about 100 years, the population of London trebled. So it went from about 600,000 to about close to 2 million. And during that period, therefore, they had to meet the housing demand. And they did it, as you all know, with the pattern book of homes that were just rolled out, Bedford Square included. And Bedford Square was part of a sort of catalogue that was very British. And it came from, I suppose, the building regulations, the Great Fire of London, very British way of dealing with squares and facades. And this great building here, or these buildings here, are part of that. But these buildings were all houses at first. In the 1780s, there were, I think, six or seven houses in the AA, all bourgeois houses, occupied by large families, now occupied by 1,000 students. So there's something very interesting about a building type that was built with catalogue elements, balustrades, newel posts, fireplaces, very handsome, grade one listed, that is now occupied in a completely different way to that originally intended. So when we build our housing, maybe we should be thinking about the future, can we do something that will allow us to adapt and alter those dwellings to not just be dwellings, but also to be places of work or study. And if I can just give you another thought, so we've talked about the regional versus the global. Talked also here, I'd like to find a way of debating how flexible, how adaptable our buildings need to be, and how they can change over time, even if they are set down for one use now. And the last question for you, that I'd like to raise at some point this evening, if we could talk about, is how do we balance all of this? Because we're headlong into building more housing, but we also have to build places of work, study, entertainment, and so on. And I think we've got to be careful that we don't head down a route of it's all got to be housing and end up with cities that are dormitories, or large parts of our cities that are dormitories and capable of being nothing else. And you can see here some of the statistics that this is the area just to the west of here, west and south of here, that is losing places to work. And just to give you an example of why this is important and how this is changing, there was, until about two or three years ago, quite a clear drift to residential property in terms of value. Residential properties were maybe twice or three times as valuable as office properties, commercial properties. That has changed. And there's now a complete equality between the cost and value of office properties. Now, the market is reacting, but we can't rely on markets to build our cities. So, with those thoughts, over to our first speaker, Bob Allies.
Thank you very much.
Where are you? Yes?
Nope. I think I'm that one. Yes, that one.
Command L. Help.
Yeah, I'll try again.
Command L.
Right. 5 minutes isn't very long, so I will probably talk quite quickly and just try and make a few, try and make these 5 points that we've been asked to make. But I want to begin with also with a little bit of history. In a way, when we look at the challenges that we face in London in terms of the amount of housing we need to build, and also the extent of the failure in London of, in England actually, of building at the right rate that we need to meet that demand, it's interesting to be reminded that there was a time when things were very different. There's a very nice book written by Lindsay Hanley called Estates, which is about her experience of growing up in an estate in Birmingham. And her estate, which was built in the 60s, the land was acquired by the then Minister of Housing in the Labour government, Richard Crossman, in 1964, and it was completed within 5 years. And they built 20,000 homes in that time period, which is something like 2.5 times the size of the Olympic project. And they did the whole thing from land acquisition to completion in that 5-year period. So we, although it feels like a huge amount is happening, actually we are building very, very slowly by comparison with the scale of housing construction that was going on 50 years ago. The other thing about that is that her book is about how bad the outcome was. And so although they built it very quickly, the thing they actually built was not a success. And in a way, I think that her criticism of it is probably some of the criticism that probably colours the way I think about housing now, having kind of begun architecture school more or less at exactly the time at which those sorts of projects were being built. And in a way, the first thing I suppose I want to say is that I come from the position that, yes, we can have quantity and we can make quality, and we can bring those two things together. The first thing I suppose I want to say is that what we need to always remember, I think, with housing, is that housing should form part of the continuum of the city. In other words, I don't think it's sufficient to think about housing as something where you're building individual estates of housing, individual houses, individual buildings. The critical thing always is to see them as part of the city. In some ways, housing, more than any other building type, is actually what constitutes the city. It's what the majority of the fabric of the city is made of. And because of the way, particularly in Britain, we own it, it lasts a long, long time. So the moves we make when we design housing, I think, are really important ones. And therefore, I think we have an obligation to use our housing to shape the city and to ensure that in the character we give it, the way it relates to streets and so on, we are consciously enhancing the wider environment in which we're building. This is our project in St. Andrew's Bow. This is another one of our projects at the Arsenal, where we converted the old Highbury Stadium into flats with a garden in the middle. But as well as this big space, the scheme then was able to adjust to smaller scale spaces, courtyards at one end of the site, and then ultimately to mews at the other. So it was capable of making the sort of transitions to connect itself back into the rest of the city, which is something which I think is so important. Perhaps the most kind of complex project, which we've recently been working on, which tries also to deal with this issue, is this project in Lambeth, where we've actually ended up designing a series of buildings of very different scales and characters, which actually negotiate their way around quite a complex set of circumstances to do with existing buildings, existing fabric, but also in this case, a new relationship with the very large scale development taking place in the Nine Elms development immediately to the north of our site. So that's my first point. The second point is in a way something which one maybe doesn't need to have, wouldn't have needed to worry about, but I think now one might need to, which is that all the housing we've built has all been built under the circumstances of building a percentage of affordable housing as part of a project. I mean, all our work has come from the private sector, but it all contains an element of affordable housing with a variety of tenures within it. Now, that has been a method for achieving some construction of affordable housing at a time when there was very little other money to do it or opportunity to do it. And I suppose the anything up point I want to make here is that as we move into a time when, in a way, something I welcome is happening, which is local authorities are again beginning to build their own housing, I do think that this phenomenon, which has really been a byproduct of a need to get affordable housing built, is the fact that every project we build is always a mixture of tenures. So there's always a range of people living in all of these projects. And I think that has been an enormously important shift and one that we should be wary of losing if we see housing being provided in different ways in the coming years. So this project, I mean, it contains its proportion of affordable housing. Actually, I don't even know where it is within the project, but that's, you know, one of the things which I think has allowed these projects to work well. The second thing I just want to say about this project, this is the St Andrews master plan, the images I showed you earlier, and it shows a series of buildings arranged around courtyards. Now, obviously, London's tradition is the one of the terrace street. Actually, as the densities go up, it is very, very difficult to build housing using that typology. We continue to try and do it, and we continue to try and build streets, but we have found that this typology of the buildings arranged around a courtyard has become an increasingly valuable one to use. And I suppose in this one, I just want to make one point, really, which is that there's been a huge debate about the privatization of public space or a kind of reaction against gated communities. But I think that what is true is that when you're building at the sort of densities that these are being built at, that actually the provision of communal space, that is space which is not public but is shared by all the people who live there, is actually an enormously valuable ingredient of a housing project. And I think something which, again, I think we should look very carefully at before we lose that as an asset. So that's point number three. The next point is that that's a view of one of the courtyards in the St Andrews Bow scheme. The next point is that I'm showing another courtyard in another project, an earlier project of ours, which is actually a conversion of a college building into a flat, probably about 10 or 12 years old now. And what you're looking at was a light well in an old building, now becoming a courtyard shared between flats. And one thing about this is that you could not build this project as a new build building because the flats are just too close together. They go against the regulatory system. And I think we are in a funny situation now where we've established in London very strong regulations controlling the design of housing, most of which is a very, very good thing. But two things about it. One is sometimes it becomes a sort of constraint which actually forces a certain type of urban morphology onto the city, which isn't always going to be the right answer. And also, and I think this is more of a debating point, it is tending to produce buildings which are very, very similar to each other. Because as everybody has to provide balconies to every flat of exactly the same dimension, we're beginning to create an architecture where almost inevitably we all start doing the same thing. So I would very much like to see some kind of change in that regulatory system where there's a sort of 85% compliance rule or something. So you don't have to do the same thing everywhere. There's a bit of kind of tolerance in these rules to make life more interesting. The counter argument is that, of course, well, what are London terrace houses but almost the identical buildings built endlessly across the capital? So you might say, well, that's the nature of housing, that it tends to become uniform in this way. This is just, another view of the courtyard. The last point, really, I have one thing to say after that, but the last of the 5 points is actually relates to who builds it. These are just a couple of images of some of our housing projects. They're actually projects where we've been able to carry out, to produce the working drawings and been able to supervise the construction of the projects on site. So although they're very straightforward housing, very economical housing, we feel we're achieving the quality that we're after. But there is no doubt that there is a huge issue now in London in terms of achieving quality, I think, which is that probably the majority of housing is now designed by an architect up to planning and is then built by another architect for a much, much reduced fee as the thing is carried out. So that what you see is a decline in standard. And I think it's a thing which almost all housing architects in London now face, is seeing their projects being built by other people. And it's a very difficult problem. It's not an easy problem in planning terms to find a way through it. But actually, I think unless we do, I think we will actually see a decline in quality in the years ahead. Now, I want to just say one last thing, really, which is about density. And I've just put on this picture. This is a project of ours in Aldgate, which consists of three quite tall buildings, 20 stories or so each building, with a hotel in the middle. It's the densest single project that we will have built. And it's right in the heart of the city, so perhaps it's logical. But it has made us think about density and how we measure density. And I suppose I do come from the position that I think density is something which has always been something which has frightened people in the past. And one always talks about things being too dense, as if density is always a problem. But of course, density is really what makes cities sustainable. The denser they are, the less transport you need, the more efficient you can be, the better resources you can introduce. So that there are huge gains in density as well. And therefore, it's interesting to try and understand what are appropriate densities to use. And we wanted to try and find another way of measuring density, which was actually to do with effectively what is an individual's footprint, how much land do you occupy where we live? Incomprehensible in that form, but that was the sort of question we were asking. So what we came up with was with that formula, which suggested that if you took your site area for a project and then you deducted the area that you were giving back to the public as public realm, so roads, footpaths, parks, everything, you then saw what the percentage of which was residential by comparing with the other area that you were developing, whether that was shops or any other offices or any other use that might be involved, and then you divide it simply by the number of people that you were expecting to live in your project. And what that would result is an area of land, so many square meters occupied by each resident, or the residential footprint. And what was quite interesting was that when you look at specific schemes about using that analysis, you find that a typical London terrace house, actually we use around 30 square meters per person. So that's about the area of land that typically London has allocated per person on a residential project. Now, as it were, for good or for bad, but it's an interesting to have a number, the St Andrew's Bow project that I was showing you, the area allocated per resident is actually 5 square meters per person. And the area on the Aldgate project is 2 square meters per person. So something is going on here, and there are big changes which we find ourselves a party of. And I think you can either sort of look at it and say, well, this is an alarming change. Are we going too far in terms of density? But I think you can also acknowledge that actually, as people live at higher densities and are prepared to live at higher densities, so the city potentially works better. And I'm going to stop.
We had 6 points there, so we can only have 4 from Colin. Please do come and give us your, I think you're next, Colin. But if we can just keep it a bit shorter so there's time for debate.
This is the This is the plan Alex was talking about earlier, which is a plan based around the opportunity areas in East London, which are some of the biggest brownfield sites in London. And the first point I'd really like to make is that you do need a plan to deliver quality and quantity. Of course, I would say that. I am a planner. You know, traditionally, before the 1948 Planning Act, it was plans that delivered housing. It was a plan that delivered the square. Planning then was done by the private sector, by the estates. That's how suburban London developed. So it wasn't the state who had control of developments, it was private individuals, but it was still planning. And it was planning to make a return and to make a living out of building housing. I mean, I'm still quite surprised at the absence of clear planning in lots of parts of London about what uses might be. And Alex touched on, you know, residential and office. And an interesting point Alex raised, you know, the piece in The Guardian saying, oh, isn't this terrible? We've lost 74,000 jobs in Westminster because everything's going to housing from office. I started my first job in Westminster in 1990, and what was terrible then was everything was going from housing to office. So my job was to crack down on all these bad people who were converting houses into offices. Now, of course, the way cities develop is very long term. So it's probably appropriate, it's Alex's birthday, because I think, you know, over a 3-year period, probably no big point in getting overly worried about a trend, which will probably reverse. So since 1990, you know, housing has been more popular in Westminster at times, offices at other times. I think over the piece, the thing balances itself out. There was a colleague of mine who retired at Westminster who gave his little pep talk when he went, and he'd been there for about 40 years. And the point he was making was, you know, are there such things as good and bad uses? You know, is housing bad? Are offices bad? There are policies we have, sometimes we have them for good reasons, but you know, they're not intrinsically freighted with morality or goodness or badness. And I think as planning professionals, as design professionals, sometimes have to bear that in mind. So here it is, a plan, and what it is getting to the heart of is where might you have housing, where might you have industrial uses. It's not just about housing in London, there is a big demand for industrial use because a lot of industrial uses have been lost over the last 5-10 years or so. So what we're trying to do there is give a bigger picture, do a bit of active planning. So this is a plan prepared in our office by planners. And the other thing it's picking up on is something that's already been referred to by Bob, which is where does this sit in a bigger picture? So this plan is about 28 kilometres by 15 in scale, so it's very large. What's the relationship of London to the wider southeast, Thurrock, to the docks, to Tilbury, to DP World Gateway Port. They're the sort of shipping equivalent of Heathrow on the west. And they make this place desirable to invest in for industrial and potentially desirable to live in because, you know, you've got this great influx of stuff coming into London at the ports and it's got to get into the city at the other end. And you have these locations in between, which are currently full of very large empty sites. Not particularly pretty, certainly not desirable. The Thames Gateway project, which was launched back in, I don't know, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, was probably a bit of ahead of its time. The reason it was ahead of its time was because the population of London was a lot smaller. And as it starts to push against its limits, that's why there's an opportunity here now, because there's a demand for that land and for those locations to build on. But we can't do that just by looking kind of inwards into London. We've got to look at places where people don't necessarily look towards City Hall, but they look out towards Essex and Kent. If you want to deliver design and quality, you've got to look at management, at political decision-making and management of the development process. So the state has nationalised development rights, and it's a nationalised industry which has been remarkably robust, as all other nationalised industries have fallen away. Planning is still owned by the state. And increasingly in London, because governance of local authorities is by cabinets and by leaders, it's very politically led. So if you want to get decisions and write decisions, you have to have a good connection between people like me, people like developers, and political decision makers. And in London, there's a two-tier government, strategic, the GLA, and local. And if you don't get the connections right between the levels of governance, things can go very badly wrong. There can be enormous delays, and there can be a lack of clarity. And so the plan I showed beforehand, if you want to make that work, then you need, and here's a management board chaired by one of the deputy mayors, and below it you've got the leaders of Havering, Barking and Dagenham, and you've got chief officers and deputy mayors from the GLA. Now, Havering and Barking and Dagenham are neighbouring boroughs, but before the beginning of last year, when we had a meeting in March of 2014, the leader of Havering, the leader in Barking and Dagenham, never really met to talk about anything, which surprised me. And actually, when they did meet, they found they had quite a lot in common. And knowing what they want, and me knowing what the various deputy mayors want, is really important for delivery, both of quality and quantity. Land use plan. Here's a land use plan. It's very simple, a very large area, but it's something called strategic industrial land, where you get big industrial uses in the east, and that's the Ford Dagenham plants, largely, which is kind of over here. It's a place called Barking Riverside, which Alex is doing the master plan for. And so here we're just showing simple designs, relatively, to connect Barking Town Centre to Barking Riverside by relocating some of the big, heavy industrial uses. Something else we're showing is relocating industrial uses from a place called Thameside West, which is in the Royal Docks. Thameside West at the moment has some interesting things in it. It's got the Tate & Lyle syrup factory in there. Anyone familiar with Tate & Lyle syrup in its tins? The same machinery from 100 years ago is making the tins still. So, you know, the cutting edge of British industry is alive and well in London. And there's also a paint factory there. And there's also a factory which boils down animal remains, a meat rendering factory, only one on the M25. But is that a sensible place to put those things when you just spent 9 billion quid on the Olympics, which is just up towards Stratford, and when you're spending £1 billion on the other side of the river at Greenwich Peninsula, and you've spent X billions on things like the dome and all that sort of stuff. So it's just a simple land use plan which helps deliver some certainty. And something else, another third point about how you can deliver quality and numbers is, what do the public sector own? So this is a map. In red is all the things the GLA own in this part of London, which is quite a lot, and the orange we part own, that's Barking Riverside, and the yellow is showing the housing zone bids. So government has an ability to invest in housing, which is a way of getting numbers, but also guaranteeing quality. And I think procurement is a key thing in how we procure quality, and are there different ways we can sell land? So can we sell land in a way where we don't take payments up front, for instance, so where we could take them later on, so that we can get the numbers delivered? Do we always have to be driven by best consideration, where we get the most money, but we don't necessarily get the best quality, or we don't get the numbers, or we have a really long delay because it all gets very tortured through the planning process? It seems a bit surprising that you could be a public authority and both be selling land and giving yourself planning permission. Shouldn't that be quite easy? Surprisingly, it can be quite a stupid process, which is to nobody's benefit, really, particularly the public, because it's all taxpayers' money that's being thrown around. Fourth, and nearly final point, infrastructure. This is transport infrastructure. In parts of London, you can make enough money, like a Vauxhall Nine Elms, to pay for very expensive transport infrastructure, like the Northern Line extension. In East London, you can't really do that. The stuff isn't worth enough to take value out of it to pay for things like the Gospel Oak Barking Line extension, or where it says there, potential major scheme to reduce severance. We've changed that. What that actually is the undergrounding of the A13, the kind of fly under, which Boris mentioned when he was in Boston earlier. It says potential major scheme to reduce severance because TfL wanted it not to mean anything, really, or to not tip anybody off about what we were doing, which is another problem, I think, sometimes with public planning and public plans. That a lot of people involved in planning in the public sector are quite keen to produce things which nobody can really understand, because then you won't upset anybody. But it can be quite counterproductive in the long term, so we do try and avoid that. But anyway, this is a transport plan, so some simple things like Gospel Oak Barking Line getting extended to Barking Riverside, which Alex is doing the master plan for. You could tunnel under the river there, and then you come up in Thamesmead, which has been a really long neglected part of East London, and was a setting for Clockwork Orange, as you may know. Peabody have bought that, and they're looking to redevelop that. So you can start joining the dots up fairly simply. And of course, Crossrail currently stops at Abbey Woods, which is down here. Ooh. Currently stops at Abbey Woods, but if you extended it, you could make it run off over to Ebbsfleet, and then you're joining, again, joining the dots up, Crossrail, Overground, etc. And my final point, and on infrastructure, one point that often gets missed is utilities, sewers, electricity, gas, really dull-sounding stuff, but a major delay in delivering large numbers of housing, and a surprising disconnect between the providers of utilities and the people who make these plans, like me. And we have been trying to get to know each other over the last year, and the mayor is promoting that. But these things are very expensive, they can be very complicated, and they can create enormous delays to kind of big delivery of projects. And my final point is affordable housing. Affordable housing provision, 20 years ago, it wasn't actually delivered through the planning process, so you weren't required to provide affordable housing as part of your bid for housing. That kind of 30 years ago, actually. It's kind of 1990s. And affordable housing provision is desperately opaque and complicated. It's become more so recently because lots of people have been doing things called viability assessments. Personally, I think if there was a fixed rate for affordable housing of about 30% in central London, you could just really simplify provision of affordable housing. You could simplify delivery, and you could simplify the calculations people do about how much they're going to spend on buildings and how much quality they can deliver. At the moment, it's kind of got into a little industry of itself, which is good if you're involved in that industry, but bad if you're looking to have a home provided for you. So my final point would be, yes, affordable housing, but I think there are ways where we could dramatically simplify the provision and request for affordable housing. Thank you.
I've been totally ineffectual in keeping you guys to a time limit. So you'd be okay? Very quick, because otherwise these guys are here and they want to talk and debate. Thanks.
Okay, I might not even. I'll try not to use my slides too much. I'll fly through them. My name's David, and I kind of always tell stories that are very pertinent to my life and my experience and how I grow my practice. So I'll do that because I guess we're kind of on the coalface, you could say, and experiencing the extreme change that London's giving us. My practice is 10 years old, and our business plan 5 years ago, it was really interesting hearing the biog of me and the fact that it was all outside of London. Because 5 years ago, our business plan said London. That was our business plan. And extraordinarily, over the last 5 years, all I've done is work in London. All I've done is work with my studio, which has grown from 20 people to 40 people, working in London. And pretty much all we've been doing is working on housing-led regeneration projects. To such an extent that the new business plan is to get out more. I like short business plans. And so suddenly we're pitching in Norway, we're pitching in Sydney, we're pitching in New York, and I promised my team of extraordinary designers that the next person that comes and offers us yet another 400 to 500 home mixed-use residential-led master plan, we might say no to, which is a really weird thing to be honest about and put to you. But it's interesting because we were warming up with Hugo earlier, and he said many students here would say to him back 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, whatever happens, I don't want to graduate and go and churn out standard boxes for Barrett. But you might have noticed, if you were following carefully, most of Bob's slides, and he's an extremely good architect and designer, and he's well-chosen slides tonight, most of those slides were work for Barrett. And so it's kind of perverse that actually that's what ends up happening. And I think it's wonderful that that's what ends up happening, because we've actually got someone who is pushing with those standard developers to become better than standard developers, pushing themselves beyond and improving the quality. I must admit, on numerous occasions, to have taken St Andrews as a scheme and said, that's a great example of what future standard London could be, and actually grabbed it in Google Earth, copied it, pasted it onto another site, and said, that'll be all right for the stuff of the everyday. If we can achieve that, fantastic. And actually, we'll crack on and do this weird thing over here in the corner, whilst I've just proven to you the site can achieve this. And do I feel guilty about that in some ways? But then actually I kind of subscribe to some of the things that Bob said, which are actually, as long as you get the standard stuff right, as long as you build it into the fabric of the city, as long as we've got sort of the simple stuff okay, then crack on onto the place. And so I guess that's probably my open comment really, is to just learn from London and learn from what works and make sure it then is crafted into a good place. The next funny story, I guess, is in that first starting point of the next 5 years, 5 years back, we were challenged to look at Earl's Court. We were challenged to look at how to create 7, maybe 8, maybe 9,000 homes on the site of Earl's Court. In fact, I think we were competing with Bob and his crew, alongside numerous others. And I remember the briefing was fascinating. The briefing was, and I've not heard this since, London Plus. I thought that was really intriguing. I find it really intriguing to see Bob's slide of the Vauxhall project, which to me is London Plus. It's about adding layers. It's about sort of saying, I learned from this. You're comfortable at that point. You're comfortable at 8. It's going to be 16. It might be 25. It might be 30. But it's London Plus. And I guess my point to throw out is that in making London Plus, we can acknowledge the layers of the city, we can acknowledge the roots of the city, we can acknowledge the keeping of key elements of fabric, and the actual layering of additional things on the top. And we need to make sure that we're actually creating those mixed-use places. Third point, I suppose, is that urban intensification. If we intensify the urban stuff, we believe fervently we need to intensify the landscape stuff. And so if we intensify the units, if we intensify the density, and I love these calculations that have been shared, then we should be intensifying the green stuff. We're working with Alex out in Kidbrook, a very challenging brief, a six-story hotel. Optimize, let's turn it into a 20-something story residential tower. Is it a good idea? Question mark. It can be a good idea as long as we actually intensify the public offering, as long as we intensify the public realm, and as long as we intensify the amenity space for the residents and the kind of the mixed use offering, the kind of landscape offering. So intensify everything is a key point I'd like to make. And then lastly, I suppose I think the challenge going forward is actually London plus, which is actually the acceptance that when we see more and more and more projects, and I've been at a briefing recently at Battersea Power Station, and then been shown a slide of the real Vauxhall Cross when it's all built out. And we've just finished an extraordinary scheme in Mill Harbour, Mill Harbour Village, which is our biggest scheme so far. 1,500 homes in 6 buildings. So the average building height is 40 stories. Wow, did I expect to do that? I've got the slides, I'm not going to show them. Maybe they'll come up later. But the crucial thing for that is that we were working on our project and realising that actually, whilst we were working on our 6 towers, there were actually 45 towers in the pipeline, all of which are pretty much peaking at about 45, maybe 50 stories, which means we are going to have these extraordinary lumps of mini Manhattan, dare I say, mini Hong Kong, landing in London. And so I suppose, in that sense, the fact that most people's briefs are just space standards, that'll do. An amazing achievement a few years ago. I think it now needs to be space standards plus. And funnily enough, the only way we seem to achieve that on our schemes at the moment, because the space standards, the London plan standards, are now, of course, why would I build a square metre more? What we're pushing for is the flexible envelope of the balcony, of the winter garden, of the extended living space, because that seems to sort of fall out of that space standards and becomes the more generous area where we're able to change. And that's actually what we've championed in our last few schemes, and actually I think it's going to be very exciting to see them. There, no slide presentation. There were 35 slides to show, but I nailed it on 5 minutes, I'm sure. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Vere, if you could just...
So I'll be talking from my personal perspective. I'm a young professional kind of trying to live in London. And when I was invited to come and talk about quality versus quantity in London's housing sector, I kind of had to think by myself first, wait, I hardly see any quantity nor quality in the city in a way how I approach it, trying to live here. So to begin, I'm not a developer nor an official architect, and I don't work for the government. And kind of the biggest connection I have to London is the fact that I rent a house. But that said, the conversation of housing is, for as long as I know it, and I've studied here for quite a while, stuck in this kind of mystifying terminology of vacancy tax having little to do with vacancy, public benefit schemes having quite little to do with public benefit, help to buy that doesn't help you to buy, and affordable homes that remain unaffordable. So housing is political. That's a fact, but not just because housing occupies the city, but mainly because people who are also citizens live in it. So rather than come up with five solutions how I think housing should be tackled, I propose five questions concerning London that to me illustrate what needs to change. The first one is who owns the city? So I actually asked this question from a graduation project to the mayor of London, and I got an answer that it was too complicated to answer. So London, the city that we kind of believe to be ours when we walk the streets, is actually owned by corporation after subcorporation, with nothing more behind it than value. So this image here shows all private corporations owning London from the room where we sit in AA looking eastwards. So to kind of put it bluntly, Oxford Street is a company without me realizing it. Holborn is a company, Nine Elms is a company. And companies that can fully decide what is happening on their land, from private security agents to luxury apartments and shopping malls. And in a sense, London, open during business hours, has more reality to it than the freedom to roam, let alone demonstrate nor build a home. And in that sense, my first point is that I think ownership of the city needs to be transferred back into the, or needs to be transferred from large property developers back to the users of the city. Second question is, who profits from the city? It's 1987, and Margaret Thatcher's friend John Broome won the right to buy Battersea Power Station for £1.5 million. And somehow, 30 years later, without any physical change to the site, nor nothing much to its surroundings, it sold for £450 million to a Malaysian company developer. So what happens to a city where most money is actually being made reselling empty sites? I mean, what do you expect when I can make more money with doing nothing than with actually trying? So to begin the conversation about housing and housing supply, let alone quality, I would propose an end to land banking and a cap on any profits made by land banking. Third question is, who rules the city? So citizens can kind of vote on certain developments. More importantly, they can halt developments when they might shade their garden or increase neighborhood density. But somehow we can vote on regeneration, but we can't vote on a percentage of affordable homes. A topic like that has never been open to a referendum. So I would say that national government and local authorities need to redefine their responsibility concerning housing and the city. And often sentences like, but it's a neoliberal economy, it's not like Germany or Holland, or I'm Dutch myself, therefore I bring it up, or the private sector doesn't really care. They're thrown around, but there's a really, really simple solution to it, that regardless of who owns the land, these are all the plans of the GLA, by the way, who owns the land and what land it is or what government is in office, nothing can be built without at least having a 40% of affordable homes. The fourth point is who builds the city. So development in London is confined by view access to Westminster. But where do we build if we can't build up? And architecture as a discipline of basement extension surely can't be it. This is an example of a basement extension in Kensington, going up 3 to 4 stories down. And somehow in current legislation, and me trying to kind of go through planning now as a starting architect, it seems to be easier to extend my property downwards than to actually add a third story to my second story flat in Clapton. So I would say that one of the big kind of struggles and solutions to tackle housing and quantity is actually to look at innovative ways to build and use space, whether it's through simplifying planning, adding density, shared ownership schemes, or even a kind of Airbnb for housing. It could change the way how we use and see the city. Therefore, I'd like to conclude on a point: who uses the city? And somehow, during my graduation project, I was struck by the question that why a busy street in Aldgate can be worth less than a private garden in South Kensington. And focusing on Nine Elms, actually, I reached out to big corporate developers in London. Think of Jones and Lezang, Ballymore, but even embassies that operate as kind of property developers, and spoke to them to establish a new form of ownership and therefore value. What I was proposing is to replace rental built in prospective value, that is kind of prospective value, with user value. And that means that if I rent a house, I actually sub-own a house. If I stand on the street, I can actually sub-own the street. And by doing this, I propose a spatial occupation that is neither public or private, but therefore can also make money and is valuable. So I think this threshold of what is public, what is private, is a very important step next in how to look at housing and how to look at actually quality in housing. Because there's one kind of simple rule that if it's yours, you treat it well. If it's not, you don't really care. So I think for me, that's where I will end.
Thank you very much. And by the way, the last two speakers were very short, so we'll give them a bit more time. No, we'll give them a bit more time in the questions. Can I just throw it open to the audience? Should we put the lights on a little bit? And if you guys want to sit here, throw open to the audience questions, comments, issues you want debated. Put your hand up. I don't know how, is there a microphone? There's two microphones. Come on, guys. A bit of a polemic on the last one. Who owns London? Who owns London? Too many property developers? This is the AA, come on. Do you want to elaborate? If nobody's going to ask a question. Yeah. Go for it.
There's a lot of different things being put on the table, which I think is really good. But I wanted to pick up on one of the key points that Vere was making, which she made a very clear statement that housing is political, but in the richest sense of the word, it's not sort of political in the sort of party sense of the word, it's actually a fundamental issue of decision-making in any society, actually how we organise it. And that goes from everything from the larger scale of planning that Colin was talking through, right down to detailed design and space standards and all the rest of it. And it seems to me that it's one of the biggest problems, and something that the AA should be doing more, but also architects should be doing more, is actually to address that head on, that we need to talk more about the quality of what we want to do and why it's not happening in a much more political way, as well as doing designs, and to become, in a way, more engaged with that argument. Because if we don't do that, then we're always just following along behind decisions that are made by people who are not interested either in quality
more necessarily in quantity in terms of meeting the needs of Londoners. So it's that sort of focusing on how the designer and the architect can become sort of more politically conscious of the way in which we practice.
So question, are architects and planners politically conscious? I think, I don't know if you want to talk, Bob, about the amount of time you spend in consultation. Maybe Colin, are you politically conscious? I think you've got political masters at every level, haven't you? So do you want to pick up on those points?
I mean, I suppose I feel there's like two slightly different things here. One is in terms of the quality of the housing that's being built. I think in the end, it's probably a vastly varying standard, and that's the truth is. So there is probably some very good housing being built by some very good architects in London, and they're building housing in accordance with the rules which have now been set by the mayor. And those standards, if they're applied, are on the whole, I think, achieving a standard of housing which is acceptable. You know, so I don't look at those standards and think they're wrong or they're inadequate. I think on the whole they are good enough. My concern is more to do with they're almost too much of a straitjacket in a sense. So I don't think that's the issue. I mean, I do think the thing which is complicated for an architect designing housing in London is that however much you know, all you can really do is take it seriously as a project. You know, you can take the brief, you can take the regulations, you can look at where you're building, you can talk to people, and you can do the best building you can. But in the end, these bigger things are operating kind of above you in terms of who's actually buying them and how they're being used and whether they're occupied or not. There's a whole lot of other things going on which are just simply outside your control. And it's very difficult, I think, in a way to tackle that issue. I mean, for a long time, I felt that we were suddenly building a lot of housing, and I felt this is great. London has a huge housing crisis, a huge shortage of housing. This must be a good thing that I'm doing. But actually, you know, then you sort of suddenly see how some of that housing is being occupied and being bought and sold. And obviously, it is a much more complicated thing. But I think it's quite difficult. I mean, you know, architects can kind of change track and get caught up in that and try and do that, but I don't think the problem of the quality of housing is necessarily to do with the standards that are being set by the GLA.
Can I just, before we ask maybe Colin, just a straw poll, how many of you think that the housing that's being built at the moment is better than, as good as it could be, and how many of you think it's deficient? So who thinks it's deficient? I'm not going to ask you to speak, but just so. About 30% think it's deficient, not good enough. And how many think it's good? How many think it's okay? It's good enough. It's great. One. Right. So.
What do the others think?
Well, the others are not convinced either way, I'm assuming. But so that tells you something. And Colin, do you want to just comment on that? So who? I mean, and some of the questions that Vere raised, you know, who controls it? Who controls the land? You know, why do some people benefit from the land without having to do very much? And, you know, if they're right and the housing isn't very good, why is that?
Just coming back onto the point about, slightly off the point, actually, I sort of went to San Francisco back in the summer, and I thought it'd be completely unlike London, but actually it's remarkably similar in that if you're under about 35 years old, you can't afford to live in San Francisco, because you're just, and people my age, you know, sort of late 40s, old people older, have just been very lucky, you know, because they've bought into a city when the city was, you know, sort of flatlining a bit in terms of population. And just by how, you know, just sheer chance of when you're born, you know, I moved to London in 1990, and London's housing market in 1990 was functioning really well. You know, so I could get flats rented and then go on to buy one, no problem at all. But I think if you're, you know, the younger people in our office are in many respects a bit stuffed, really. You know, how do you afford to live in a city that's successful? And San Francisco had that same thing, really successful now. But, you know, how you share that success depends. And interestingly there, I think they do have a system, in kind of Californian system, where you can vote down plans. And they've recently voted down proposals to have buildings of a greater height around the Docklands area, apparently. So they had a more kind of direct democracy, you know, where you can see it on the TV, advertising for propositions and things like that. But nonetheless, still have, on the face of it, a similar housing crisis, where, you know, they're just not building enough to meet the demand that's been created. And I suppose that there's a wider problem, you know, as Bob's talking about, where if you, you know, if like me, you bought a property in the early 1990s without doing very much, and I can guarantee I haven't done very much, the property I bought, you know, the capital gain on that is probably more than I've earned in that period. You know, and how is that fair? Well, it's not particularly fair. And then you're getting into a wider problem of people generating money just by owning things. So you just sit on a piece of land, there's no incentive to develop it in, you know, in some spectacular cases, and you can just gather more and more capital. And you know, that's a problem as well. It's kind of a problem a bit difficult to deal with as an architect or a planner. Because you know, I'm not a revolutionary, and if I was, I probably wouldn't be here at the moment. You know, I'm kind of working within within a system and trying to make that work as best you can. I mean, the point I was trying to make about politics is yeah, it's absolutely essential to make sure that you are influencing and are getting the right messages from politicians, because they you know, they hold all the really important levers when it comes to what private capital can do, can't do with the money. I think the point about London, you know, is it owned by corporations, is it owned privately? I suppose it's historically it's always been a bit like that. That's the kind of place it is. And I think in some respects, that's why, you know, it's successful in some senses. I mean, in others, access to living in London, it has become unaffordable for large chunks of Londoners. So,
can I just come in, Vere? What do you think? Do you want to answer that question? But also just bring in Holland, because Holland is always put up as a sort of paragon of virtue. Tell us about, you know, another place where it's done better and why.
Okay, well, there are two things here. The first one is that, I'll bring this here. While studying London for the last few years, I was actually surprised by how much of the land was in private hands, to the point that it would kind of define the way how you could live there, whether it's walking through Broadgate and not being able to take a photograph. And looking kind of in depth at the layers of legislations that is in place in a city, that is actually more kind of holding development of housing back rather than forward. That was just something that surprised me. I mean, I think in Nine Elms, I tried to capture and speak to all the landowners there, and I was in a conversation with more than 30 people, but none of them were taking any responsibility of what was actually going to happen. I think that problem of scale of who owns what is very complicated in London. An example of Holland, but it is a completely different culture, and after the war, there's always been at least 40% of 30 to 40% of affordable homes. So it is completely different. But what we did well, I suppose, in certain areas is that we initiated private home ownership and got a kind of free card there within planning for private individuals that bought a house and whatever to design their own facade. And in that sense, you create places that have a history, that are individual. Examples like this are the Canesim Islands. I don't have an image of it, but it's kind of a new built canal, but rather than one big developer deciding what's happening on both sides of the water, it's a set of 40 individual owners. It was young families that kind of chose an architect at a discount price to design their facade. I think those initiatives, they come from government, they support kind of young professionals, and they create equality, can actually lead to a sustainable city. Because it is, yeah, once, I think that's the problem here, that the scale in London of supplying housing and a personal connection to it is a bit off grid. Because I think I'm a good example now of what's wrong with London, is that I've studied here, and now kind of being independent, I can't afford to live here pretty much. And that's just, no matter how good of an architect you will be, or no matter how successful as a planning company, that is a bit scary, and it's not really feeling the right way. And I think in a conversation, you shouldn't forget that.
Okay, other questions, and then we'll pick up on some of those points that are not finished, and we'll have David in. Lady over there. Gentleman over there, lady. Who?
Different kind of topic, housing still. Someone told me that London, the central gravity of London moves, has been moving 1 mile eastwards every decade. And my question is, what would happen if we accelerated that drift radically? With that map in mind of the east, every time I come in on the A13, I look out of my car window and think, if we built at the density of Mayfair, we could house 500,000, probably a lot more. And the big question is whether that is being looked at and thought about, and what would allow that to happen?
Yeah. Well, since David hasn't had a chance to speak, and you're doing these huge plans at with 45-storey towers, tell us how that can happen.
Well, I guess it's beyond Mayfair, isn't it, the thing I was talking about. I think that's, if I imagine what is had in mind for the kind of the eastward expansion, I think it's at least at that density. I think it's very, very likely. I think the challenge is simply about the benefits and the negotiation during those master plans about giving things back to the community as well. I actually think the density will happen, because I can't think of a single person who's asked us to do a low density scheme in the last 5-6 years. I'm very, very rare that we actually get asked to make houses, and it's in incredibly small proportions. And it's, you know, it's but we've been asked to achieve 20%, but could you kind of achieve 3 or 4? That'd be great. Colin's championing houses as part of the kind of the London Riverside or Barking reach opportunity. But of course, you know, the Mayfair density is a really good example. And I guess that goes back to the conversation about London Plus. And, you know, London is mansions, townhouses, maisonettes, and sort of this, the kind of rather lovely arrangement of that. London Plus is that plus a bit more. And I think that's going to become the norm, actually. So for me, it's not actually a challenge. I think it's going to happen. It's just how fast that can happen, and again, the quality of it. My take on quality is simply that my experience is that the public-private partnership, although it's a bit obvious, is actually, from my experience, the best way of achieving quality. The finest buildings from my practice have been the result of public-private partnerships. You know, our first major building in London, the Clapham Library building on Clapham High Street in South London, is a public-private partnership with London Borough of Lambeth and Cathedral Group, and it's a very high quality building, and it's a very high quality public space, and it's a very quite high quality public offering because of it, and we were retained to do the detail. So many other times when that public interface isn't there, the detail is not demanded, the quality of space is not demanded, the kind of quality of public offering is not negotiated, and again not demanded. And again, the perversity, and I love the 85% of standard, the perverse thing is that whilst that project, and I wouldn't even call it a building, that place that's lifted an entire high street and a community that surrounds it, has won 12, 13 awards, we could not now build it because of the London plan and the GLA standards. And we simply could not build that project again, and I find that baffling because it was only complete 4 years ago.
Can we take another question over there, the lady behind you?
I have two questions. First one was regarding as a young professional in the city and trying to be affordable, I think, is the private renting market is growing exponentially in London, and how do you address the standards of those rentable apartments? Because, I mean, young families and young professionals can't afford the affordables, so they move to the private rental section, and then those standards are, from what I've seen in my time here, have been subpar and still astronomically unaffordable, and you do it, and then you have to evolve into the next place. It's the same cycle over and over again. Should that something be regulated? How can that be regulated? To what degree, I think, is a major point because it's growing so vastly in London. My second question is a little bit different, more regarding the, as Bob was talking about earlier, with how the standards have a tendency to create similar type projects. Is it possible to create different type of standards towards different typologies to keep that urban fabric of London that's so unique, yet still create density and character simultaneously? Is it completely unfeasible to have different standards depending on location, whether it be adaptive reuse of other buildings, of brownfield sites and things like that, and new build, or et cetera?
Do you want to give us a clue? Who would you like to answer your first question on the private rented sector?
Can I say something?
Because
yeah, so I was surprised this morning. I received a letter, and I live in a very badly isolated home that I rent in Clapton. And it's very, very badly isolated. And I wouldn't recommend living in Clapton right now because I just think of the cold. And it's all fine, I pay my electricity bills, but we got a letter saying, actually, you can get a discount if you upgrade the insulation of your home. You can get like whatever kind of money and accounts will support it. And I was like, oh, that's great. And then I realized, but I'm not a homeowner. So how am I gonna be forcing the homeowner of the flat that I'm living in to actually do this? And I have no idea. I mean, it's hard for me to even get money to paint the walls white because there's stains on them. So this entire kind of system of what the responsibility is of those who supplies the houses are completely in disconnection to what the government tells them and allows them to do. So I think that's a great point. And I think for me, that's part of my frustration that I don't see a way there. But it would be great. I mean, that's more something for the GLA or any other body to install. I don't know, but how can we enforce that?
Can I just make an observation about ownership, which I think I've got the figures more or less right. Roughly 60% of dwellings in this country are privately owned. Roughly 20% are rented in the affordable sector, and roughly just more than 20% privately rented. So one of the things you're looking at is actually the 60%, Colin and myself, who own our homes, we are the ugly landowners that are dwelling on these properties. And the curious thing is that the big landowners, like the Grosvenor Estate, the Bedford Estate, are the ones who are thinking more globally, more strategically about their properties and upgrading them, making them fit for purpose, because they have a 200-300-400-year time horizon, whereas, dare I say it, Colin and I are just thinking about ourselves. So there is some complexity to this, that the obviously big landowners aren't necessarily the target. It may well be the small landowners that are. So, you know, you need to... And when it comes to private rented, there are some very big schemes by large landowners, so the Olympic Village, which are modelled more on the American model. I suspect you're from North America, where there is a successful private rented sector and has a pretty high standard. So I just put that comment in. The second question, which is about different standards, who would you like to answer that? Or does anyone want to pick?
I can throw something in. The reason why I quipped that we would be challenged, and my studio challenged me to say no to the next 400 to 500 home master plan we were given or offered, is the last time we... is that most of the time we can actually almost draw the standard solution that meets planning compliance, GLA, I'm sorry to draw it in like that, but the kind of the housing design standards in about 5 minutes. And it means that an architectural audience particularly is very challenging, because truth be known, I know that the developer will mostly ask for 16 meter wide block, probably kind of protruding on one or other side to make sure that we have dual aspect or at least corner aspect from the middle of the block. Definitely celebrating the corners of each of those. Definitely no less than eight, but probably no more than eight apartments per floor per core. And that actually, I'm afraid to say that most of the Barking Riverside, no, the Nine Elms Battersea Park up all the way through to Nine Elms, is that repeat. And I'm afraid to say most of the accommodation that we're seeing on most of the larger scale sites is exactly that thing. And architects just become potentially, unless the architects are really driving and working with their client who wants to deliver something different just because, possibly because there's a level of heat in the market that says maybe we need to deliver something better and different, or because they've heard Colin speak, or they've heard Bob speak and said, I need to do something better. Architecture can become the decoration of building, the decoration of a development schedule. And that's
What's wrong with that? We talked about George and London and Victoria and London.
But why do
architects have to build all this housing? I mean, maybe we're the wrong people to be doing it.
Well, exactly. And that's that. There's the real heat of the debate, because the standards are very similar across London, and most of the new stuff is in the outer edges and the kind of the bits of land that's sort of semi-edge condition. And because of that, then we're inheriting 18-metre kind of amenity distances with a classic 18 to 21-metre kind of rule on the overlooking, and it's very similar.
The young lady over there on the left.
I mean, the UK works with a developer model. That's, I mean, George and London developed as a developer-led project. Model, yeah. So I think that is quite difficult to change. I mean, other countries that haven't followed that route. But what I find with the space standard is that at least it gives you an argument. And I feel that if you didn't have the 50 square meters or the 60 square meters, the developer will say, okay, we'll do 40 and 35. And it is true that there's a huge market for micro flat if you want. But when they put the examples, they put a very highly designed Manhattan example. And that's not what the developer is actually going to do. So for me, it's, I mean, I have worked in quite a few residential projects and kind of planning a stage. And I find at least the standard gives me a way to fight for a bit more space, which I think is important, because unless you have a very well-designed interior to work with a very small footprint, you end up with a shoebox, really. So I don't know. It's you don't feel at all that the standard sometimes helps.
I think standards are wonderful. I think it's just a rather open mind to the interpretation of those standards. I have no problem at all with the fact that standards have been set for London. That literally becomes the minimum, it becomes the base, it becomes the litmus test. I think the challenge is, and I think it's incredibly important how Bob started his 5 minutes, in that he said we need to remind ourselves we're just a point in time. We always need to look back and then look forward and then carry on looking. We're at a point in time exactly right now that there's an incredible shortage, and everybody's desperately trying to build faster than the other guy or girl to get it onto the market, whether it's sold locally or sold internationally. Add 10 years onto that, at this level of change that we're having now, and I bet you we'll be having a very, very different conversation, because I think we'll be finding quite quickly that there's a huge amount of rental stock, we're fortunate to just start working on Eastwick and Sweetwater, which is right next to Olympic Park, inheriting the legacy framework of Allies and Morrison. 1,500 homes, at least half of those, touching 1,000, will be specifically aimed at the PRS, the private rental sector. And suddenly that home out in the middle of beyond Hackney Wick suddenly will not be quite as desirable as the new homes that are being built, because of the standards and because of the competition, frankly, that, hey, come over here and rent my flat. No, come over here and rent my flat. No, come over here and rent my flat. It's inevitable, it will happen.
Okay, so I just want to make sure everybody gets a chance to ask a question. Yeah. I'm fine.
Well, I'll try speaking out loud.
Just something about picking up on what Bob said about the number of situations where architects design the first idea, put forward the first stage of a project, and then it gets taken over and finished by whoever it might be. And how far architects, maybe architecture schools, have become rather superior about the kind of everyday crafting and making residential buildings. The Smithsons talked about a high standard of ordinariness. But I wonder, what do you think, Bob? And should the schools rethink the way they're operating, the way they're teaching? Because this thing of the amount of building that's really needed is serious stuff. Mm-hmm. Are the schools doing what they could do?
Well, yeah, it is an interesting point. The kind of consequence of thinking about, of saying that housing is a fundamental part of the city and that it is one of the things that structures the city is, of course, to acknowledge that it's going to last a long time. And so one thing I must say we are more sensitive to on our housing than any other building type we work on is the idea that this stuff has to stay there a long time, has to be easy to look after, and it has to look as good in 30 years' time as it does on the day you build it. And I think housing has, it's very unusual actually to have that discipline of saying, you know, are you making something which is really going to be going to last? And also housing which is easy to look after. I mean, one of the things actually most worries me about some of our projects is the scale of cost, the cost burden in terms of service charges that we're putting on tenants. I mean, you know, not only do you have to pay a huge rent but you also have a huge cost in terms of a service charge now, which I think is, I think is going to be an increasing issue actually for a lot of these projects. So I think, you know, the architect has a responsibility there, and I would like to feel that in the end architects would have that capacity to see through their projects and build them well, and would be very good scrutineers really of what they're doing and try and get there. The problem is that when we bid for projects and we get planning approval and then we're asked to bid for the project to take it through to site, and there are other architects out there who will do it for a quarter of the fee that we think is appropriate. Well, the reason they do it for a quarter of the fee is because actually they don't care very much. I mean, put simply, not worried about it, and therefore they're going to see this thing through.
I think copyright doesn't apply.
It doesn't really help you.
Our experience is very much similar to yours. About 80% of what we get consent for is designed by others. But I think the reason that we are employed in the first place is the planning rules. That we would, the same architects who bid a third or a quarter of it would do the planning if they were given the chance. But because of the planning regime, they're not given the chance because they're presumably not good enough. Do you want to just pick this up? Because you see it all the time, and maybe you're disappointed when you see schemes that you've given consent to that just don't look right.
Well, I think there has been a real shift in, you know, from 2000s to today. So, you know, in 2000, I would really meet you on housing schemes, Bob or David, you know, you just didn't get that. So, And again, before, you know, I think as long as you're aware of the potential downsides of the housing standards, and they're not regulations, they are not standards. There's 69 suggested things that you might think about. But certainly within our team, you know, I always encourage people to look at them as that. You know, they're the things that you can make a case for having exceptions to. And I think generally where we get good designs with good rationales for doing things in a slightly different way, we're quite happy to look at that in a different way. But I do accept that often in boroughs particularly, and often, you know, people like rules because then you don't have to think. You know, you can think, well, it says, you know, 1 to 10, and if you don't tick them all, then you're wrong. you know, we don't, certainly within the GLA, we don't encourage people to do that. It is meant to be about thinking about these things being applied. But going back to the point about, I think quality has definitely gone up, and I think housing developers realised they had to get in better designers. The market in London kind of can sustain that, and there is a demand for that. Certainly, when I meet some developers and designers from outside London, you know, it's kind of around the London fringe. I mean, it really is a very, very different world. In terms of the architect kind of union, and can the public sector insist that people pay your fees? Yes, it can to a degree. So you know, you can condition, and we do encourage developers to keep the design architects on. Can we do that in all cases? Not necessarily. And I think sometimes, you know, there might be issues within firms that, you know, if you've got huge schemes,
not everybody.
You know, you might have to kind of subcontract some of the stuff out. So there are all those things to consider. But I think overall, you know, the quality of people involved and the aspiration, I mean, it's just really changed fundamentally. And just back on David's point, I don't think the Mayor's Housing Design Guide necessarily generates the same solutions. And everything looks the same. Yes, I'm really familiar, you know, with the corner units and the three units through the middle, you know, and that's one outcome. But Nine Arms, that was there this morning, is really interesting because River Lights, which is Graeme Sturck, you know, we produced the plan, the GLA, which showed a perimeter block, not because we were demanding perimeter blocks, it was just to give an indication of what you might have there. But, you know, he came up with four finger blocks. Which are really, I think, a fantastic scheme. It works really well. And on the other side of the road is your scheme, which is like way well on its way now. And across the road is a scheme which is quite unlike Roger, you know, the Graeme Sturck scheme, which is sort of a perimeter block, but with towers, small towers on it, so you get the light through. Very different form. Both of them broadly conforming with the Mayor's Housing Design Guide, but looking completely different. You know, I don't think it necessarily generates a generic response. And miraculously, almost, within those things, there are genuinely affordable housing units, although, you know, I would say not, you know, it's 15% out of the total, so maybe not such a huge number.
Can I'm going to give Vere the chance to close, because she asked the five questions. We'll find out if she thinks they were answered. But before she does, do you want to have a word?
Yeah. There's many people. I have a question. Okay, so my is a really open question in the sense that I would really like to hear from somebody any sort of answer, because when I arrived in London in September, I sent an email to 200 developers in London saying, look, I'm a young architect, young designer, and I think there is a lot that could be done. There's a lot that could be done in London to do variations on housing typologies. I think the housing typologies that are being built in London currently are very boring, no? I find they're all very boring in terms of typology, in terms of facade, in terms of architecture overall. And if it's true that we have all these supposedly creative people that would like, I don't know, the traditional family, it's not that it doesn't exist anymore, but it has been questioned over in a number of ways, no? Mama Bear, Papa Bear, and the two little bears, for all which, you know, all the new housing in London have been designed. So why do we keep designing just houses for them? Why, I don't know the question, I don't know the answer, really. I'm just, would like to know if there is London is such a variegated metropolis and so on, why is the market so stuck on itself? Why doesn't any developer has some sort of idea of saying, okay, let's try to develop something radically new? Because anyway, I have a lot of money, I'm building 200 developments, I can do one that is a bit different, I will risk a bit, and then I can sell it for more expensive, no?
Okay, just to say, most dwellings now are built for one and two bed flats. 60% of dwellings in this country are occupied by either one or two people. The family concept you have is slightly out of date. That it's moved on from that.
I was saying that since that concept doesn't exist, the family doesn't exist, why
people aren't building family housing. In fact, Colin's trying to convince them to build larger apartments. Do you want to just pick up on that?
Yeah, I mean, there are developers coming forward with new typologies, and you know, actually one of the things they're running up against is to a degree a planning system which, you know, doesn't recognise those typologies. And one in particular is accommodation which doesn't meet the space standards, which is aimed at people graduating. And so rather than, you know, being in a remote location in a freezing cold flat with all sorts of issues about maintenance, couldn't you purpose-built rented accommodation on a you know, smaller room sizes, but maybe with shared amenities, which is purpose-built, which could be offered at a rent which you could afford if you've got your first job. So we're talking to developers about that, and again, not necessarily looking like your traditional block of flats necessarily, which is an issue the mayor often raises. You know, sort of, why does it all look the same? So yes, people are looking at other typologies that aren't aimed necessarily at families, that are aimed at you know, people like yourselves who are struggling to find accommodation. And you know, we're certainly up for talking to them about that and how you could bring that forward. I would say there is a tendency within the planning system to say, oh, so, you know, that's new, so it must be bad. I try and encourage colleagues not to think that way, and we are, you know, we're looking at something that I think you're describing.
I think, oddly enough, I think in a way that there's a sort of, it's you might say it's one of the downsides of the fact that there's a housing shortage. In other words, developers, are house builders, are not really having to compete very much to be able to sell or rent their flats. You know, so actually, you know, if there was a surplus, they'd all be madly trying to work out how to be better and more interesting than everybody else, in a way they don't have to do that. So I think that's part of the issue. And I think probably another issue is that the land values are so high in London now that the kind of entry into development in London is also set at a very high level for people. So actually, you know, it tends to be dominated by people who can make that kind of investment. I think land value actually is a really critical issue. I mean, even the question of the proportion of affordable housing and this process of viability testing, which irritates Colin so much and irritates me as well, actually, because I look at our projects and I'm told that the viability test has proved that we can't do 30% housing. And I look at it and I think, how can that possibly be? You know, this is an enormous housing, but how can it not comply? And the reason it doesn't, I'm pretty sure, is simply because of the value of the land that was paid at the beginning of the process. So the person who's made the money is actually the person who bought, you know, who sold the site, as it were, and they made the money. And then everything else trickles through, and it's very hard to claw that back.
So lady over there.
I think that's why David Porter's suggestion was pretty good, because if you went to the extremities and got your land, presumably slightly cheaper than where it's very complex, where there's already development, and have good infrastructure connections, really smart ones.
Yeah.
It would be a pioneering thing to be part of that new development on the absolute extreme, and you'd get the same kind of potential enthusiasm you had in the early garden cities or Queens or something like that. You'd build a community in concert with actually making the buildings.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, the problem with what's happening at the moment is apartments bought on plan, not being lived in. It's tragic, you know, very dead parts of London.
Yeah. Can I just say, I don't want to ask Colin again because he's had a couple of shots, but one of the discussions is how you release land. So in Hammarby, for instance, in Stockholm, the municipality prepares the land, prepares the plan, and releases the land in smaller pockets to developers and architects, so that there is much more variety, much more interest in the. And the same in Rotterdam, I think you have the same idea. And it isn't sold just as land to be developed. It's sold as land with a consent or an outline consent. And smaller pockets are sold at a time, so that the smaller developers and the younger architects can have a go at it. And that's why you get those self-build projects in Rotterdam, for instance. Any other, just I want to pick up any other questions, because I can see we're 10-2. Young lady over there.
I have a question. I have a question about the private and the public space. I've been today to the Sky Garden at 20 Fenchurch Street, and I was quite amazed about what it was in there. And I was just wondering what's the new translation or the contemporary interpretation of private and public space in London.
Can I just ask, were you amazed good or amazed bad?
I think in a bad way.
I thought so. have you been to the Sky Garden?
No, I haven't, actually. Right.
But, I mean, that's a central part of your question of who owns the public realm.
Yeah.
Does anyone want to answer?
I mentioned something about this in my talk, in a way. It's very difficult, this, because everything, your description of the way things are is true. So one can't really argue with the fact that the way London works is that the ownership of land is very complicated. Personally, I have never found it to be a problem for me. I've never sort of found I'm terribly worried about knowing exactly who owns what. And actually, some of my things I most enjoy about London, sometimes I realize are places which are privately owned, but I know I can walk through, so I walk through them. And I think the ambiguity is actually an interesting quality. So I'm much less clear that to simply say, oh, everything must be public, is the right answer. I think actually it's kind of interesting the way London has evolved in this way. And even things like garden squares. I mean, you know, who owns the garden out there? I mean,
the Bedford Estate.
The Bedford Estate.
We have to get permission from them to put the tender.
And does that matter to me? Probably not. You know what I mean? I'm quite comfortable in the way that, in fact, I like the fact that the Bedford Estate has been around for about, 400 years and still owns it. And, the AA, it left the AAB here, but they had to get the key and everything. You know, I think in a way that's quite interesting, as interesting as Camden owning it, which is the other possibility, really. So I think it's easy just to kind of say, oh, it's wrong, but I'm not sure whether it is quite as simple as that and whether there's a sort of something intriguing about it. So, I mean, a bit of me feels, there's an answer about that. The other thing I suppose I feel is the one I mentioned, which is really that I think that if you live at quite high densities, then it makes an enormous difference if you have a piece of communal space, which is feels, well, I mean, two things really. One, it feels safe, so your children can play in it and you can, and in a way you can offer something which otherwise is very difficult to offer in a high density place to live. But also in a funny way, it is a way of framing communities. You know, there is a sense in which that group of people live together and they share something. And I think that is also a strength. So I think in a way we should be quite open-minded about how we control space and construct it. And that it's almost these in-between ways of owning space which are some of the most interesting.
Any other questions? I'll come to you.
Possibly on a slightly positive note for affordable housing and provision affordable housing, there's a recent challenge to the High Court on a freedom of information request for the viability assessment that was done for the Greenwich Peninsula, which the GLA own. But essentially, there's been an issue about some viability information being confidential, and so lots of others say, well, you can't see it, and the reasons that this particular judgment circulates around are ones which are quite common to the debates, which you can't see it because you wouldn't understand it, so there's no point showing it to you. It's got things in it which are commercially confidential and which will prejudice our business of property development, so you can't see it, but the percentage we're saying to you is affordable is honestly the most we can do. Rather fascinatingly, the judge has said, no, I don't accept any of that. The developer, have to be open about all the calculations you've met to arrive at the viability, which has set the affordable housing level in your scheme, because decision makers, politicians, both at the GLA and in this instance at Greenwich, need to know that information, but not only politicians, but local people. And the argument there was there has to be a public interest element on freedom of information. And helpfully, the judge said the delivery of affordable housing in London and the mix of communities you get in London, where you have both maybe richer people and people with less money, is a public interest issue. And therefore, developers have to release that information. That was a judgment last week, followed on one in Southwark, where Southwark had been challenged about the Haygate estate redevelopment. And I think that potentially will have quite a significant impact on affordable housing provision and viability work. You know, to my mind, is mostly bollocks. Really. It's just absolutely made up. Existing use values can be manipulated to get to any answer you want, basically.
I'm conscious it's 5 to 8. So should we just say one or two more questions from there, the young lady there? Who else wants to ask a question? Anyone else? You want a second go? Okay, those two, and then we close, maybe with a couple of comments, closing comments.
Quite interesting discussion because... We keep on talking like about the term affordable housing, and then at the end, when you put the price tag on it, it's like for people earning 50k, and like where is the affordable housing for people earning 20k? Like, is it just a term that we can just change? Like, well, it's for people 40k, so it's a bit affordable. And I've seen that situation in a borough that I lived in, which is called Hammersmith and Fulham, so in the same area where Elscourt is, and it was a Tory borough, and they actually sold the social housing to a project made by Foster's, and like the whole notion of affordable housing and social housing was just gone. They were just going to demolish it, and until like now Labour is in power, they're going to try to reverse it, but which is impossible because they already sold it to the developers. So I think, in a sense, we do kind of have, as citizens, a bit of control of, because we do kind of choose our governments. But on the other hand, like, it's funny when architects get told to make, well, it's not even, it's like developers, get told to make affordable housing, and then they sell it to someone who makes it cheaper, and then it's like the whole, it's kind of lost in the discussion, and you just give it to someone cheaper, but you actually sell it much more expensive. So,
okay, but the point you're making is it's not very affordable. And why is that? Can I just make a point, which is that, in a funny kind of way, what you have to recognise is the growth of population, because there are a lot of people paying relatively affordable rents, very modest rents, and people at Coin Street who are trapped in their flats or houses, because to move out they would mean they'd pay more rent. So there is actually a lot of affordable housing that is genuinely affordable, but people are stuck in there in it, and there isn't enough to go around. I think the issue is, if you look at those numbers, we are growing in the last 10 years, we grew 1 million. The next 10 years, it's projected to be another 1 million, 100,000 people a year. We're building in London around 30,000 homes.
I think actually this year we'll be getting on
40,000 homes, okay. And there are around 2.5 million homes in London, something like that, dwellings in London. So it's a small number that's being added, even though it perceptibly, Nine Elms and Barking and so on, it seems to be a huge increase. Actually, it's a small number dealing with a large population increase. So whatever you do, it's going to be a struggle. Does anyone want to pick up that how affordable is affordable point? Pocket housing, you were alluding to pocket, were you?
Yes, pocket is one of those kind of offers which is different, which isn't quite space standards, but which the GLA have funded, where you essentially you get yourself a mortgage to buy yourself a flat, and within the terms of which you get the lease on the property, you're only allowed to keep, you have to be within a certain income bracket. And when you sell on the property, you can't take all the value out in terms of capital appreciation. You have to sell it on to somebody on a similar sort of basis, on a similar income. So it maintains the property as a kind of subsidised property, and it's a slightly different twist on providing affordable accommodation. The property you're describing is kind of intermediate affordable, where where the income level is up to 60,000. And if you go for, if you're a family, it's up to 80. And I think 80% of people in London, 80%, actually 80% of households in London are on a household income of less than £60,000. So, you know, it's kind of, if you do the maths with the 7 million people, that's a lot of people who qualify for that. I mean, so, I mean, I'm the team I work in, everybody qualifies for affordable housing. You know, the generous pay rates of the public sector. So the rent, and the rented is slightly different because rented is based on a kind of median income within London, which is very similar to San Francisco, actually, the way they do affordable housing there. And I mean, there are lots of issues around that. Like you say, you know, you get who you vote for or who you don't vote for, and changes in housing benefits and the idea of a kind of more flexible, affordable rent, which means instead of being about 40% of the market, you can go up to 80%, means that even in the rented accommodation, there's a huge variety in what's affordable.
Okay, you know, I just want to, sorry, cut you short. Last question, I'm assuming that's last question, then a few closing comments.
Thank you. In regards to how Colin, you were speaking of the GLC now acquiring land, now going to be building on the land, similar in the fact of post-war housing crisis. Who, like in post-war housing, the LCC and the GLC had the architecture departments that basically, actually a lot of AA architects came from and built a lot of housing complexes and things like that, a lot of great ones. Not much public interest in those schemes, but so today, are you guys gonna be using a similar type process where you have your own architecture department going to develop those lands, or how does that work?
So the GLA is purposely set up to be a fairly small organization. That's what City Hall is about. You can only fit about 600 people in it. That was done on purpose to stop it growing a kind of empire all of its own. So whilst it has a planning department, it has a housing land team. So that's about developing land and bringing it forward. You know, in the GLC, there were 10,000 staff, and there's a whole architects team. There was a, you know, great machine for bringing that stuff forward. I think one of the great shames of closing the GLC down was that when it shut down its architects department, and London's population was declining. I think the skill of designing high density housing and housing generally just went really, and there was this kind of hiatus for about 15 years. When all those skills were kind of forgotten. So I think in the 2000s, you know, our observation about changing quality, when there was a kind of drive to up density again, you know, I think people didn't know what to do. You know, nobody likes to admit they don't know what they're doing. When I turned up the GLA, I have no idea about how to do strategic planning. I thought I did, but it took a few years to figure out. You know, there's quite a lot to learn. And I think the same had happened in housing design. In terms of the lands, which is on the slides, of which we own a lot, originally that was purchased by the London Development Agency, and they had a talent for buying land and making it worth less than they paid for it, which is not terribly helpful for the public sector. But now there is a real drive on to bring that forward. Including things like, you know, can you in effect give the land to a developer, to smaller developers, let them develop it, and then they pay you back what they make. And it gets you out of this cycle of having to guess what the value is, and you get things like existing use value, which basically means the landowner trousers all the money, probably off to Bermuda or somewhere, and the people who lose out, you know, the people here in this room tonight. So the GLA housing land team are looking at ways of kind of bringing forward that land so that rather than just taking as much money out as you can as the public sector, you're trying to deliver your own policies. But in terms of who designs that, you know, that's you know, David and Alex and Bob. Because I think it's better that it works that way, and certainly I don't think government is going to evolve next 5-10 years to have 10,000 people working for the GLA.
I'm just going to ask everyone to close, but I'll take that as a closing comment because it signals a real change in the way in which these developments could be brought forward. If you take the profit out afterwards as the local authority or the regional authority, it means that you don't have to trade the land at the highest possible cost. Bob, do you want to just make a couple of closing comments, then
yeah,
David, and finally
Vere? I want to make is that in a way it's... You know, one can be gloomy about the situation, and there are lots of things that are clearly going wrong in the way housing is working, and it has become an enormously important issue for London. But compared with how things were, 40 or 50 years ago in London, what's amazing now is how everybody wants to live here. In the 1960s. London Borough of Kent and Chelsea was selling streets of terrace houses because nobody wanted to live in them. When I first came to London, I got a hard to let flat in Kennington because nobody wanted to live in it. And London was in a kind of decline, you know, and nobody wanted to be in the city anymore. And so for all the worries I have, I still think it's incredibly exciting. That everybody wants to be here and they want to make it work, you know. So, I feel positive, even though, because in a way that's such a better situation to be in than the situation where the city is being rejected and people are moving away. Now, clearly, if it gets worse and you all start moving away because you can't afford to live here, then we'll have another problem again. But I think we should try and solve the problem, as it were, but enjoy the fact that there are so many other good things about the city.
David.
I must admit, I feel extremely positive as well, and I feel extremely positive because I showed you one slide of 35 slides tonight, and they were all a bit more colourful, but the 34 slides that I didn't show were all of an extremely diverse array of quite extraordinary architectural projects, and I'm delighted by the pressure that London feels and the change that London feels because it just ignites pockets of London that have never been considered before. From amazing projects in Erith Quarry, where's that? Where our client is ambitious enough to not talk to anybody else about how he's going to design and build a school, not follow the government regulations, but design the most extraordinary school at the heart of a new ecological neighbourhood. Wow! Because he just wants to, because he feels the initiative and the urge, through to the transformation of Erno Goldfinger's Balfron Tower, to the transformation of the amazing Alton Estate in Roehampton, which just sat there feeling sorry for itself for the last 25 years and is now having a makeover. And I would reiterate that this is a moment in time and we should relish this moment in time. And I do think that more and more and more super talented architects should take housing incredibly seriously and train for it and relish this incredible moment. I was lucky enough to, when we won the competition, when we were competing for the Roehampton Estate transformation next door to Richmond Park, I was lucky enough to discover where the original architect, happily to say still alive, lives. I cycled down to see him and heard him tell me the story of how he was master planning, his time, his challenges. And he was very clear on saying, those were exemplar, those were extraordinary, those were pushing the boundaries, and those over there, they were just the GLC standard typologies. They're back to front. They're rubbish. I would knock them down tomorrow. Quote, unquote. 21st century society doesn't want to hear that, but this is the original designer that says that. And okay. I find that really exciting that we're in this time we can...
Two optimistic judge. Notes. Actually, I will give you a chance. Can you be optimistic?
Oh, very optimistic.
Yeah. And you know, working from 1990 to 2000, it was a bit dull, really, in London. I can remember the excitement of the London Eye coming in as a planning application at Westminster, and people going, "Blimey, it's massive!" You know, could you believe it'll never happen? It'll never happen. And I think that would it happen had just gone out of the city entirely. You know, on the upside, I could get myself a flat. I live in a GLC flat and have done for 20 years, not too bad. Some coal bridging issues, but you know, nothing you can't live with. I mean, absolutely share, you know, the optimism and excitement, and what a great place to be, just a, you know, kind of freaky place in history when, you know, it's all going off and it's expanding up to, you know, 10 million plus, and which has engenders, you know, working with some, you know, really inspiring, exciting people, and which is a great place to be. With lots of people kicking around, lots of different ideas, which I suppose is a lot of the reason why I live in London, and I guess why lots of people come to London, that kind of exchange of ideas like this, you know, where people care about what they do and care about the city they live in. My older children are now kind of 18 and 21, and they're still living with us. And so I'm certainly incentivized to think about what potential solutions might be.
That sounds very optimistic to me, that they're still living with it. Vere, do you want to, you asked four questions. Who owns the city, who profits, who rules it, and who uses it? Have you had the right answers, any answers?
Well, the only answer that's there is that it's finances, and I think we're all agreeing and that's clear. But I think what's interesting now is that everybody's turning positive, and I do think London City as a project can be very positive, but being a young professional trying to live here, it's not a project, and it's actually not that optimistic. And I think as an architect and as a developer, it is important to put yourself in the shoes who you design for and not talk about it in numbers and spaces, but talk about the lives that will be lived.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much to the AA for hosting this. I think it's really great that you've opened up and you're talking about these issues.
I just wanted to say that the debate goes on, the conversation goes on next week, if you've got the energy. Next week it's suburban versus urban, where will you live? And I think it'd be very important and interesting to pick up some of the points today about how far can we push out and how far should we be pushing out to give new opportunities. And the final week on the 25th is going to be the one which I think will interest everybody here, which is Housing Young London. Are we facing an exodus, which I think a lot of people here are really highlighting that as a very big issue and one which we really need to face up to very seriously. So thank you very much.